My name is John Michael McGrath. I'm a retired Navy captain, and I flew in the Vietnam War.
After graduating from the United States Naval Academy, Mike, as he likes to be called, earned his wings on November 22, 1963, the day President Kennedy was shot. With a wife and two young sons, Lieutenant McGrath headed to Vietnam.
I joined my first squadron, Attack Squadron VA-146, in Lemoore, California. In the first year of the war, 65-66, I completed 157 combat missions, flying off the decks of the USS Ranger. After an 8 month retraining, and I rejoined the war in 1967, where I flew a total of 179 combat missions in North Vietnam.
On June 30th, 1967, Lieutenant McGrath took off from the USS Constellation, flying an A-46 like this one. Right after firing on a North Vietnamese bridge, he was hit by enemy fire just south of Hanoi.
My wing was torn apart, my airplane went into a spin, and I had to eject. During the ejection, I was injured with compression fractures, a broken arm, and a dislocated knee. So after a few swings in the chute, I was captured by enemy troops.
In his book, Prisoner of War, 6 Years in Hanoi, Captain McGrath drew many illustrations that demonstrated the horrors of his treatment by the North Vietnamese.
I was taken to Hanoi, where I expected medical treatment. But in Hanoi, I jumped into the experience that 476 POWs in North Vietnam experienced. I was immediately put into torture. After 2 weeks of torture, they finally broke me. I started giving them distortions and lies and made up stories, anything I could to keep the enemy from getting anything of value. For the next almost 6 years, I spent my time in the Hanoi Hilton or the auxiliary camps around the Hilton, and I got to experience all of the horrors of being a prisoner of war in a communist prison camp. But the Vietnamese denied us everything, and they interrogated us daily, and they were trying to destroy our faith in our God, faith in our country, faith in our president, faith in our military. Everything we believed in, they tried to subordinate and put down and destroy. But they failed. They failed miserably.
Through faith and determination, POW McGrath endured and lived for the day he might return home.
I have asked for this radio and television time tonight for the purpose of announcing that we today have concluded an agreement to end the war and bring peace with honor in Vietnam.
People were overjoyed. They were overjoyed that the war was over and their prisoners had returned. And then I found out about a program where people wore bracelets in memory of us and support of us with their prayers. And you know, I suppose one of those people wore one of my bracelets while I was a prisoner of war.
Captain McGrath supposed correctly.
During Nancy Brown Park's homecoming in California last October, I met Doreen Long, the daughter of past National President Josie Malgard. She told me about a POW bracelet her mother had given her when she was a child. Doreen found that bracelet recently when she was going through her mother's things after her mom's death. I offered to Doreen to help her find the man whose name was engraved on the bracelet she'd worn. This is the letter she wrote me after our meeting. Hi, Karen. It was so nice to have met you at Nancy's homecoming. I hope your trip back to Colorado was pleasant. I'm excited to know that you were on board to help me in my search for my POW, whose bracelet I just recently found. I believe my mom gave me this bracelet in either 1967 or 68 from an auxiliary event to raise funds for our POWs and MIAs. I wore it proudly for a good year or so and was always wondering what could have happened to my lost soldier, along with who he was. Was he suffering? How old was he? Did he have a wife or children? How was his family doing? So many questions. I was only 10 or 11 at the time, and alas, after a year or so went by, I put the bracelet aside and soon life took hold of me, and the bracelet slipped further to the back of my mind. I would think of my soldier occasionally, but in that day and age, there was really no way of searching, at least not by my own means. My mother passed away in 2011, and slowly my sisters and I have been going through her belongings and finally cleaning out our own belongings that were left behind in long forgotten boxes. A few days before Nancy's homecoming, I was going through one of those boxes and came across my small porcelain jewelry box. And lifting the lid, there lay the bracelet bearing the name of Lieutenant John McGrath, captured 6/30/67. Well, right away it was a no-brainer. I turned to the internet. Immediately, the first article I pulled up was one detailing his capture and his ultimate release 6 years later. I was so elated. My lieutenant was found. He not only was found, but he had been awarded some of the most prestigious medals a veteran can receive. He had even written a book about his experience in captivity, which I plan on purchasing soon. And one day, I hope to find Lieutenant McGrath, tell him how proud I am of his service and sacrifice, tell him my prayers as a young child were answered, and to finally return this bracelet to a man who is very much alive, who probably had to overcome the most horrendous and terrifying of circumstances any human could ever endure, a man who is a true hero in every sense of the word. Well, if you've managed to get through this mail, Karen, I'm hoping you're still on board to help me on this journey to find Lieutenant McGrath. Thank you again. It was so nice to have met you and to be able to share this story with you. Sincerely, Doreen Long. Well, Doreen, you don't have to wait any longer. Would you please join me in giving a warm auxiliary welcome to retired Navy Captain Mike McGrath.
Thank you, Nancy, and thank you to the Auxiliary for inviting me. Just say a few words.
Please.
This is an exciting moment. Thank you very much. 50 years ago this month, Everett Alvarez was shot down. I'm going to go see him next week. He's a friend of mine. He spent almost 9 years as a prisoner of war. Floyd Thompson was there 9 years. Everett Alvarez is 4 months short. And they were our longest held prisoners of war. I was shot down a couple of years later. I joined them and spent those tough years in the prisons of Hanoi. Now, as you know, conditions were tough. There was lots of torture for everyone. For 6 years, I never sat in a chair. I lived on the floor. I never had a bed, a pair of shoes, a pair of socks. I didn't have a paper. I didn't have a pencil. I didn't have a Bible. Didn't have communication with my family. They didn't know if I was dead or alive. I was missing in action. And that's the way they kept us. They kept us in the dark. We didn't even know a man landed on the moon. But we got through all that because we had lots of secret weapons. One, we had faith in America. We had faith in our families, in our God, in our country, in our president, and we had them behind us. And there's another secret weapon, too. We had people like you. How many in here, I just want to see a raise of hands, wore this bracelet during the Vietnam War? See those hands go up? So you know what I'm talking about. The auxiliary, the mothers, the daughters, Doreen, they were our secret weapon. You guys never forgot us, and guess what? We got home, we found out about this program, and we never forgot you. So, you know, what a connection. Here we are, full circle. Now, what's some more of the secret weapons? We had great leadership. We had people like Jim Stockdale, Bud Day, Jerry Denton. We had these great leaders that said, our motto is to return with honor. And that we did. We held our heads high, and 5, 6, 7, 8 years later, we walked out of the Hanoi Hilton with our heads held high and returned with honor. So what I'm going to pass on to you, I think, we continue to serve. We went at all walks of life. But what I'm going to turn on to you is it's your turn. We're going to pass it on because now our time from the Vietnam War is past. We've closed that loop, and it's your time as the auxiliary. You have to support our troops in Iraq and Afghanistan, the Middle East, and all over the world where our troops serve. So I want to pass that baton on to you, and I want to thank you. And I'm going to close just with thought. It sums it up by one of the greatest speeches that I know of. Two sentences. Jerry Denton, when he got off the airplane after 8 years as a prisoner of war, Admiral Geiler met him at the airplane and said, Jerry, would you like to say a few words to the Americans, the American public? And Jerry said, well, yes, I would. And he said, we are thankful to our president and our nation for this day. We are proud to have had the opportunity to serve our country during difficult times. God bless America. Thank you.
Pardon me if I'm a bit nervous. This was a total surprise, and I just want to say how happy I am to be here standing before this man. What an honor. And he looks so good. So handsome, just like I imagined him. I thank you all for this journey, and like I said, it has come full circle, and I am so proud of your service and to have worn that bracelet so long ago and to have seen it again was such an incredible experience, and now to give it back. Thank you so much, Lieutenant Colonel McGrath. I don't... Can I have you sign this for me?
Doreen carries his book with her, and so she's got some pretty sneaky sisters who were able to. She said, "How'd they get this bracelet?" So we've been working on this, but this is an incredible moment to be able to be here and to share this. And to be able to meet Captain McGrath and knowing, I've known Doreen since she was that little tiny girl that wore that bracelet. Incredible life stories together that we have, and to be able to see this happen is just absolutely incredible. And it's, you know me, I'm never at a loss for words, but right now I think I am. So thank you both. Thank you, Melgard family, for making this happen. And thank you, everybody. And thank you so much for your service and what you did for our country.